Hi guys, Drew back again with Princess Craft RV, and today we are going to take a look at how to operate the systems and accessories on the Revolve EV1 by Palomino. So right up front here, first things first, we're going to talk about how to load and unload the camper. Coming down here to the front of the tongue, we have our coupler with slide lock here. So what we are going to do is we are going to, of course, position ourselves using the electric tongue jack above our ball and drop. Once we've done so, we are going to back underneath the coupler. Of course, we need to be centered there. We're going to hit the retract button on the jack until our coupler sits fully on our ball. Once we've done so, we are going to utilize this slide latch into that forward position. And just to go full circle, that is going to be the unlocked position. It does hold back in that unlocked position for ease of use when loading and unloading. So with this fully locked forward, we want to pay special attention that our two vampire teeth on either side of that slide latch are fully recessed there into the frame. Always a good idea to go back with a secondary pin and pin that into place. Keep that from potentially rattling loose or becoming inadvertently detached. That pin is not included with your purchase. Feel free to either use a spring pin or a lockable pin, whichever your preference is, and you can go ahead and source that from our parts department if you'd like. Next up, we're going to take our tow chains. These are going to be crossed underneath the coupler and hooked onto the receiver of the tow vehicle. Very important that we do skate that fine line of having enough room to make our turns left or right, but not so much room that these may make contact with the pavement. Riding right next to those tow chains, a very important piece of safety equipment is going to be your emergency breakaway cable here. Now, what this does is if these other tow components were to fail, as the two vehicles separate, this is going to pull on a ripcord, essentially putting full 12 volts to the electric brake system, keeping you from encountering a runaway camper scenario. It is very important that you have a third connection point on the receiver for this emergency breakaway, whether that be a carabiner, quick link, either one of those. And again, we are going to want to make sure that we do have the slack taken out so this does not make contact with the pavement. Hopping up here to your electric tongue jack, of course, we have a light switch that's going to give you a point of reference if you're backing up to the unit at dark, or if you need some spare light here when you are coupling and uncoupling, that's going to aid you in that. Also referenced here was the extend and retract switch here, easy up or down operation when it comes to loading and unloading. Now, if we go ahead and remove this black rubber plug we have here on the backside, we are going to utilize the stabilizer jack crank handle to go ahead and manually operate that. We'll take a look there at that crank handle when we do operate the stabilizer jacks, but they do share commonality with the electric tongue jack and the stabilizer jacks. Moving on here, we have our 12-volt deep cycle battery here. Now it's kind of an important time to kind of talk about what's going on within this unit electronically, especially on that 12-volt side of things. Of course, on the inside, we have four lithium batteries. That's going to power all of our appliances and accessories there on the inside. But this battery here is essentially going to be isolated from the camper for all intents and purposes. This only has a couple just a few things that this is going to operate. Number one is going to be powering the tongue jack, and number two is going to be giving the electric brakes that 12-volt signal when you do, of course, utilize that emergency breakaway or need to utilize that emergency breakaway. Now, the only way that this battery is going to be maintained, because it is isolated from the charging systems and what we have going on the inside of the camper, is going to be via your 7-way plug here. This is not only going to recharge that battery when you're going down the road, but this is also going to give you access to your vehicle's lights, your charging system, and like I previously mentioned, your braking system. So this is essentially going to connect the two vehicles together. So with that in mind, this does carry a bit of maintenance. What that's going to entail is two or three times a year, we're going to go ahead and remove these vent panels. We're going to inspect the water level, clear marked water level underneath these panels, and we are going to refill using distilled water. Again, two or three times a year, we want to go ahead and check that water level. And keep in mind, in a more traditional camper setup, that this battery is going to be connected to a converter, which essentially would charge or recharge this battery when you are plugged into shore power. That's not happening in this particular setup. So the only way that this is going to be maintained, again, is going to be via that seven-way. Now, in that same train of thought, that this battery is separated from the battery bank we have on the inside, this seven-way cord is not going to charge the battery bank we have internally in the unit going down the road. So a couple options or a couple scenarios that you're going to have to keep in mind is that, of course, going down the road, that solar is going to be maintaining those four lithium batteries going down the road. If that becomes not enough for you, or if you're out there, you know, in the middle of nowhere running the systems and you run those four lithium batteries down, and the solar is just not keeping up for whatever reason, you have another option here, and I'm going to kind of switch positions here. We have this cord here. So this is not like your everyday use scenario. This is kind of to get you out of a bind or to help supplement things. What you have here is an Anderson connector, and then the corresponding connector here on the frame. So in the event that you're, again, out in the middle of nowhere, you have ran the four lithium batteries down, and you are in need to like put the slide in or maybe just recharge those batteries, kind of extend your stay, what you would do is, of course, you're going to make that connection here. You're going to take these batteries up. You're going to take these leads up to your the engine bay of your tow vehicle. You would hook these directly onto your tow vehicle's battery. Now, if we go ahead and fire that tow vehicle up, of course, that alternator comes into play. That's going to allow your alternator on your tow vehicle to recharge or at least power the internals of this unit. Again, whether that be in an emergency situation or just to help you kind of extend your stay, that's kind of the thought process behind that. Also, at that same time, you're running your vehicle to charge those four lithium batteries. Might as well just go ahead and plug this and tip top this battery up at the same time. Now, this battery is covered with a battery box cover here. It very easily just slips over top. Make sure everything is routed properly, and we just are going to route the strap and go ahead and pull that tight. Moving on here, first things first is we have your stabilizer jack crank handle. Again, just to remind you, this is the same crank handle you're going to use in the event that you need to manually operate that electric tongue jack. Now, these are for stabilization. They're not for leveling. It's very important that we are within 3 degrees of level. Once we are level, front to back, we're going to use that electric tongue jack. Left to right, we're going to use the tires and a leveling kit. Again, once we are level, we're going to go ahead and run these down. It's best, these aren't really weight-bearing jacks, so it's best to handle them kind of with a light touch. We're going to come down, we're going to make contact with the pavement, maybe a quarter turn more. Same on the way up, there's no real benefit to kind of wrenching down on these. You're actually going to do harm in the long run to the drive of the jack. Now, coming up here into this storage compartment, again, kind of a lot going on with these two switches. First things first is we have your inverter switch there. Now, that's going to turn that inverter on. Basically, I can't think of a camping scenario where you're not going to want to have that inverter on. Of course, with that inverter off, you do still have 12 volt power from the lithium batteries, but keep in mind that your wall sockets aren't going to work, your air conditioner isn't going to work, things like that, even if you are plugged into shore power. So it's just the way that this camper's wired up. It's kind of a different breed than what you traditionally see. So generally, for an all-inclusive kind of experience with this camper, that Renergy switch or that inverter switch does need to be in the on position. Beside that, we have your BPU battery protection unit. Now, essentially electronically, everything is ran through that switch or through that unit. What its main job is to do is to allow you to operate that lithium battery system safely. The thing with lithium is that you do not want to discharge it. It does damage to the battery if you discharge it too much. and it is kind of temperature controlled and things like that. There's a ton of information out there available about lithium as a whole, but what this particular switch does, or this unit does, is protect you from damaging that system during use. This is kind of going to be stop number one for you, since everything electronically is ran through that switch. And again, whether you're plugged into shore power or not, this switch is going to need to be turned on. You'll see the full lights in there to letting you know that it is on. But for you to have access to anything within the camper, whether that be 12 volt, 110 volt, the inverter, everything will need to run through this switch. So that's stop number one. So for us to get power, that switch needs to be on. While you're here, might as well turn on the inverter as well. Also in this compartment, we have access here to the battery disconnect switch. Now, I don't want you to kind of confuse, you know, the battery disconnect switch and the importance of that with kind of these other switches. The main purpose of the battery disconnect switch, especially with a unit that you have like this, that you have, again, just a significant amount going on electronically, is that when you're storing the unit's not in use, you can go ahead and turn that BPU off, you can go ahead and turn that inverter on, but you're still gonna have things running in the background. Backlit displays, just what we would call in the industry nominal or phantom draws on that 12 volt system. The only way to completely isolate those batteries completely is going to be hitting that battery disconnect switch. So the battery disconnect switch, again, is going to isolate those batteries. If we were storing the unit, of course, we'd have no reason to have the BPU on or the inverter, but that's just going one step further to keep those batteries in the same condition as you left them. So make sure when we're storing the unit, we are going ahead and flipping that battery disconnect switch into that secondary position. So here we are on the interior of the EV1, and we kind of have the mattress pulled out of the way and the access panel. We're going to take a look at some of this Renogy equipment, so you can at least know what's kind of happening behind the scenes. So right up front here in this metal box is going to be where your lithium batteries are going to be stored. Now those are maintenance-free batteries, so it's not something you're going to need access to in the event that you would for some reason. It is just held in place with a couple screws. So lithium is going to be housed here. If we move right over here, that's going to be your inverter. Now there is some data that you can take from that display, although that's just going to show you how much voltage, how much you're inputting, how much you're outputting, things like that. Maybe slightly more for the general kind of consumer. They're not going to need access to that. That's why access is not really provided without removing the wood and the mattress. Also, a couple other things we have in here. Of course, we have the BPU unit over here. We have your solar charge controller over here. Not really going to explain much more than that. Of course, you can see the wiring and things like that. Moving on here, we have your 6-gallon water heater here. Now, this is a single source. Of course, you've probably noticed this far into the presentation that there is no propane on the unit. So everything inside this camper is going to be ran on electricity. So you need this is a 110 volt heating element unit. So no propane. Manufacturer has a couple of recommendations when operating this from a safety standpoint. Number one, anytime the unit's going to be in storage for more than 7 days, it's going to be very important that we do drain this and keep it free of water. That's going to help, or that's going to be very important to keep it nice and sanitary. So what you're going to do is you need to depressurize it first before we drain it. That depressurizing scenario is going to go as follows. Number one, we're going to cut the overall inflow of water to the unit as a whole. So, of course, here's our water connections. We're going to touch base on those here in just a couple minutes. But if we're on the city water connection here, just physically turn off the valve. Make sure we have no new water running into the unit. If we're running off that freshwater holding tank, just turn off that 12-volt water pump. Once we've done that, we can utilize the hot side of any fixture within the unit. So we're going to, whether that's the kitchen sink, bathroom sink, shower, outside shower, either way, we're going to go to that fixture. We're going to turn the hot side of that fixture on. Once we've done so, we're going to see a little bit of water come from the unit. What that's doing is that's just releasing the excess pressure that's within the tank here. Once we've done so, we are safe to go ahead and drain it. When we drain it, we are going to use an 1 1/16 socket and extension to back out this drain plug and anode rod. Once we've done so, you're going to see the remaining 5-6 gallons of water be evacuated from this location. Now, this is not only your drain plug, but this is also your anode rod. What an anode rod does is it acts like a magnet for hard water deposits, calcification, things like that. They deposit on the anode rod and eat away at that as opposed to the inside of the water heater. Generally, we see our customers get about a year or two of service out of their anode rod before it needs to be replaced. Starts out about 3/4 inch by 12 inch. You'll know it's time to replace. It's going to be about the size of a pencil, look very decrepit. It is clear when it needs to be replaced, and it's important to do so in a timely fashion. Other than that, it's important with a unit like this where you have a burn tube, as they would call it, although this is, again, not a propane burning appliance, you still have openings here that would allow insects to go in there and potentially nest in the appliance itself. Best to keep those out. So what our recommendation is going to be go ahead and use some aftermarket bug screens on these louvers and this grating to aid in that. Now, when it does come to putting the door back on, of course, you have a couple studs there. You're going to go ahead and put those on first. Make sure that little tab is lined up through the hole, and we give it a pull, and we go ahead and lock that down. That's going to keep that from going anywhere when you're going down the road. We have your backside of your water heater here, as well as your water pump. Now, if we are doing a full winterization process, which if you're going to be storing the units in sub-freezing temperatures, it becomes very important that we not only drain all of the water from the unit, but then we refill that plumbing with a RV-grade alcohol-based antifreeze. So what you're going to do in that scenario is, of course, we're going to follow the draining procedure that we outlined there on the exterior of the unit. We're then going to come here on the inside, and we're going to bypass the water heater number one. When I say bypass the water heater, what we are essentially doing is just creating a loop in the system so that we're not going to fill that water heater with the antifreeze. So what we're going to do is we are going to remove this valve there into the secondary position. That's going to be the inlet. Then we're going to come up here to the outlet, and we're going to do the same thing. Again, you can see we've opened up this loop in the system. The reason why we want to go ahead and bypass that water heater, a couple reasons. Number one, it's a closed tank. It's not super easy to rinse in the event that you were to fill it up with antifreeze. Also, if we do fill that up with antifreeze, that's a 6-gallon water tank. So we're going to need an extra 6 gallons of antifreeze to truly fully winterize that. So with that in the secondary position, we've created a loop in the system. So what we're going to do is we are going to fill all the lines with that RV-grade antifreeze. So what we're going to do is we are going to get a hold of this line here, this water line. Make sure you don't snag any of this wiring with it. And you can see they have this capped off. What you would do is, of course, number one, you're going to remove that cap. You're going to get your gallon jug of antifreeze, and you're going to push this right there into that jug. Once you've done so, you can go ahead and if we trace that line back, we do see a valve there. We're going to open up that valve. Now, what that's going to do is that's going to make this essentially a vacuum line. So then we're going to use our 12-volt water pump to distribute that antifreeze throughout the system. So we need to go ahead and make sure that 12-volt water pump is on. So with the 12-volt water pump on and these valves in the correct location, with this in the jug of antifreeze, we're then going to walk from fixture to fixture, and we're going to open up both the hot side and the cold side of that fixture. That includes the outside shower, the kitchen sink, the bathroom sink, the shower, as well as the toilet as well. We want to make sure that we have antifreeze through the lines of the toilet. So once you've done that, once you go ahead and run that, you see pink at the actual fixture on both the hot and the cold side. That is your indicator that all of that point A to point B plumbing has been filled with antifreeze. We'll want to let it run for a few seconds after that to fill up any P-traps and things like that on the way out as well. Once we've done so, we're ready to go for the winter. We've protected the unit as much as we can. When it does come to kind of returning things to service, number one, we're going to kind of start in reverse. We're going to go through that draining procedure that we outlined again initially. We are then going to Go a step further. You may fill up that freshwater system and drain it multiple times, make sure we're getting every bit of antifreeze out of the system. Once we are fairly certain of that, we are going to return the water heater back to service. So we're going to go ahead and open up these valves or put them back in their original position. And if we haven't already, we want to go ahead and close that vacuum line to the water pump. That is going to be normal operation with those valves in that position there. Now, right beside that, we have your water connections. This first one is going to be your freshwater connection. That's just how we're going to fill that onboard holding tank. This is going to be your boondocking or your off-grid option. Of course, that is not naturally pressurized, so what you have on the inside of the camper is a 12-volt water pump that's going to go ahead and pressurize that system, draw that water up from the tank to the fixtures and make it usable. So we're just going to stick a drinking water hose into this orifice. We're going to fill it up till we're satisfied, and we cap it off. And then when we need to use that water, we just flip on that 12-volt water switch or 12-volt water pump switch. Below that's going to be our city water connection. Of course, this is going to be used in the event of an RV park, or if you have access to running water or something like that, you're going to use this port here. Now, when we use this port, water pressure becomes very important. It's super important that we do not overpressurize this unit for what is recommended by the manufacturer. What we're going to use to avoid that is going to be a water pressure regulator. This particular regulator is going to regulate that pressure to about 50 PSI, which is well within the recommendations from the manufacturer. So this is going to hook directly onto the water source, as close to that as we can get. And then we take the spigot side of our hose, we hook that directly onto the water pressure regulator there. Now, if we're using a water filter or something along those lines, still put this directly onto the water source, then plug your water filter onto this, and then ultimately your hose onto the water filter. And lastly, we are going to make our connection here by rotating this trailer bound connection, and we're gonna make sure that's nice and tight. Of course, you do have a little rubber washer here, and generally that's enough to keep from any drips from happening. I have seen some customers go ahead and wrap this a couple times with Teflon tape. You'll figure out if you need to do that, dependent on your needs. If we drop down nice and low here, we have a series of drains. The further one back here on this white line is going to be your freshwater tank drain. So that's how we're going to drain that freshwater holding tank. And again, manufacturer recommends anytime the unit is going to be in storage for more than 7 days that we do go ahead and drain the unit. Now, keep in mind that there is the only time you're going to need to go ahead and drain that is in the event if you filled it up. It's going to be full when you do take delivery of the unit, so you will at least be draining that one time. Next up is going to be your low point drains. Those are going to be the lowest point in the unit's plumbing. That's how we are going to drain everything in between water source and fixture. All of the point A to point B plumbing is going to be drained there from these two locations. Now, just to kind of bring things full circle on how we're going to go ahead and empty all of the water from the unit. Number one, we're going to utilize the freshwater tank drain if it's been in use. Number two, no matter what, we're going to drain that point A to point B plumbing. We're going to open up both those low point drains. And lastly, we're going to then drain the water heater separate. Now, if we've done all three of those things, then the unit is going to be ready for storage. If we're storing it, if we want to winterize it, we need to do the same things. We are just going to have a little bit further or a little bit more to do. We're going to go through that full winterization process when we get to the inside and we view that water heater bypass and that vacuum port to introduce that antifreeze. But keep in mind, no matter whether you're storing the unit for, if you're going to be storing the unit for more than 7 days, you need to go ahead and do that. If you're going to be winterizing the unit, you need to go ahead and do all three of those things as well. Now, moving on here, we have our Schwintech slide out system here. Now, this does carry some maintenance with it. First things first, let me talk about the limitations, I guess, of the slide out system. So it's very important that we operate it correctly, keep that nice working nice and properly. When we're going in and out, it's very important that we go full pass. We want to avoid short bursts or partial openings. Reason being is you have two independently geared motors that are pushing that slide in and out. If you make a habit of doing short bursts or partial openings, what can happen is it can actually throw the timing off on those motors, and it's going to end up binding in its opening, and it's not going to go in or out. So it is very important that we are fully in, fully out. Now also, getting back to that kind of maintenance procedure, every 90 days, it's important to note that you do need to go ahead and lubricate these tracks. What you're going to use is a dry silicone lubricant. Again, every 90 days, we're gonna spray those tracks down. We're going to run that slide in and out a couple times to distribute the lubricant, and you're gonna be good to go. Now, please keep in mind, you have these tracks top to bottom as we see here, but we also have those on the other side of the slide top to bottom as well. And that same intervals, that same time, you're gonna wanna go ahead and treat these seals. These seals do wrap all the way around that slide out, and you have two sets of seals because the slide out seals in two directions, in and out. You're gonna not only wanna treat these seals, but you're going to wanna treat the ones on the inside of the camper as well. Generally, both of those products are going to be aerosol driven products. We're gonna go ahead and spray them down, wipe off any excess, and you're gonna be good to go again for the next 90 days. Now, we have our lug nuts and our tire pressure here. It is very important that we do maintain these properly here. Now, when we talk about the lug nuts, we are going to want to retorque those to 100 foot-pounds at the manufacturer's recommended intervals of 15, 25, 50 and 100 miles of initial travel. It's very important that we do check and make sure that those lug nuts are maintaining that level of torque. And again, that's 100 foot-pounds. To measure that level of torque, we're going to need a torque wrench. So if you don't currently own one, it is not a bad time to buy. You will be using it not only for that initial break-in period, but the manufacturer further recommends that at the start of each trip thereon after, it becomes very important that we do go ahead and check and make sure they are maintaining that level of torque. When we're running these when we're running down the road, it is very important that we do run these tires at the max tire pressure rating. For this particular unit, that's going to be 80 PSI. So, and let me just check and make sure that's correct. Yes, 80 PSI on these tires, that's the max tire pressure rating. That's exactly where we want to run them. Of course, you can find that stamped on the sidewall of the tire too. And you can also generally find that information forward of the unit on the data tag, which may or may not be underneath this door. So yeah, data tag here, it's going to note 80 PSI in those tires. And again, that's just the max tire pressure rating. Excuse me. And with all trailer tires, we do run them at the max. Moving on here, we have our sewer outlet connections here. What you have here is you have a gray water holding valve as well as a black water valve as well. Now, gray water is going to be what comes from the shower, the sink, the relatively cleaner of the two. We also have black water, which is going to come directly from the toilet. That's going to be your solid body waste, toilet paper, things like that. So a couple notes or a couple things to remember is that these valves should never be left in the open position, number one. Number two, these valves should never be opened at the same time because we want to avoid any cross-contamination, things like that. Specifically with this black water tank, it's very important that we do keep that in the closed position. We're going to use the monitor panel on the inside. We want to keep that solid body waste and that toilet paper in as wet or flowing condition as we can. So what that means for you is you're going to allow that tank to fill up, and you are going to only dump as necessary, or if you change locations, you're not going to want to travel with your waste if you don't have to. So generally, kind of what we see our customers do is they'll go ahead and they'll dump their black water first. You're going to just open up that valve. In this case, it's going to be a 6-inch pull towards the rear. That's going to, of course, allow that water to that waste to drain. And then we'll close that valve, and then we can go ahead and use our gray water to rinse that shared plumbing, which is just very little here, and then our sewage hose on the way out. Now, our sewage hose is going to connect the very same way this cap comes off. What you would do is you're going to remove that cap. You see you got some four prongs here, and it looks like we have a little bit of antifreeze from that holding tank coming out of there, which is normal. So you have four prongs here along the outside. We're going to go ahead and put our key holes or teeth there in the secondary position. We're going to go ahead and lock on. You're going to find that your sewage hose, no matter the brand or manufacturer, is going to have those very same key holes. It is a super common connection. Now, once we've dumped here, we've closed, we've dumped our black, we've rinsed with our gray. We're then going to close the gray. We can then reopen the black here, and we're going to take advantage of our black tank flush here. Now, this is a jet that corresponds with the corresponds on the inside of that black water tank, and that's going to help further kind of blast off or rinse that tank. So what we're going to do is, again, this black water valve would need to be in the open position because we don't want to overflow that tank. What we're going to do is we're going to hook up any old garden hose here. We're going to allow that water to rush in. Again, this black water valve, very important that that remains in the open position. We have our sewage hose hooked up, and we're just going to rinse that tank until we are fairly certain that we have gotten, you know, as much out as we can. Now, my recommendation, of course, this is the weekender hose that we provide. This is designed to get you started. When it does come to upgrade your hose, go ahead and find one with a clear elbow on the end. What that's going to allow you to do is get a better handle on the situation of your black water tank. You're going to rinse that until, of course, that water runs clean. What we have here is going to be a Renogy portable solar blanket. Now, this is an option that you can go ahead and add if you're ordering this unit, or you can source this, of course, directly from Renogy. Your unit may or may not have this, depending on how it was ordered. But this is a 300-watt solar blanket, a really cool. It allows you, so there's not every scenario, of course, with rooftop-mounted solar can be different. So that's excellent. It's awesome that it's there. Especially going down the road, things like that, but you may not want to park your unit in direct sunlight all the time. So what this blanket is going to allow you to do is park your unit in the shade, and then you can utilize this 300-watt solar blanket out there in direct sunlight. So what you would do is, of course, you're going to make your connections here on the camper. Now, as far as I know, you are going to have these solar connections whether you order this solar blanket as an option. So this would still, you're not tied to the Renogy solar blanket. These are fairly common solar connections. You can use that with a portable panel. You can use that however you like. But in this scenario, you would make your connection with that solar, with that 300-watt solar blanket, and you can go ahead and traipse that out into the sunlight and take advantage of, again, that 300 watts of solar with this connection port here. So right beside that solar plug, we have this nice porch light. This is really conveniently located if you are hooking up, you know, power after dark or making any of these connections after dark. This is an excellent location for that. You have a little toggle switch here on the underside of it, easy on and off. But again, an excellent location for that. Right below that, we have a standard cable fitting, a standard RG6 cable fitting. What this is just a pass-through connection to the designated TV areas of the camper. This will allow you to go ahead and feed either a park cable service or an aftermarket satellite package into the unit. So a really cool thing there. And then next up is your 30-amp, 110-volt power supply. Now, this only plugs into the unit one way. If we go ahead and take a look at this plug, you have two slanted plugs and then one L-shaped. We just line up the corresponding shapes and we plug straight in. The cool thing about this Furon power supply and door is this gives you this light indicator that kind of allows you to realize, or it shows you that you have continuity from the plug to the inside of the camper. So it's just kind of a cool thing that you don't see with all setups. But once we have, again, kind of to back up, once we've made that connection there, we're going to take that cord, we're going to turn it clockwise an eighth of an inch or so. That's going to lock it on. We then do have a secondary collar here we can screw down, and we want to make that decently tight because we don't want this to be wiggling. We don't want somebody to potentially come along and trip over our cord. You know, we just want to make sure that connection is very firm and tight. So here we are at the rear of the unit. The first thing you may notice is going to be your rooftop access here via the ladder. With that in mind, it's a good point or good time to talk about structural maintenance on the unit. So here on the unit, anywhere where you see two pieces come together, whether that's the taillight here or the side trim here, they're going to utilize some sealant. Again, anywhere where two pieces come together, there's going to be some sort of sealant. It's very important that we, at the very least, inspect that sealant every 90 days. So once we've gotten done treating our seals and tracks of the slide out, we can come here and we can inspect, do an overall 360 degree inspection of the unit. So here on the body, they're going to generally use a 100% silicone product. If you see any degradation or separation in that location, just go ahead and touch up as necessary, remove the old sealant, and then go ahead and reseal. Up on the roof, we're going to use a different type of sealant. You're going to utilize a self-leveling sealant, whether that be Dicor or XTRM. Either way, up top, it's not a precision movement or a precision, it's not a precision up there because it is self-leveling. So if you see any degradation, cracking in that sealant, we're going to kind of use a heavy hand and we are going to touch up as necessary, and we're going to allow that to kind of pull out or pull into any of that those problem areas. And again, that's going to be every 90 days. We're going to do, at the very least, inspect it. Of course, you're not going to see any of that kind of degradation, maybe many years till you see that, but it is very important that if we do see any compromised sealants, that we do touch them up as necessary. Also here on the rear, kind of some normal stuff that you would generally see on a camper. We have our tube storage bumper. It does have a cap here on either side that would allow you to go ahead and store your sewage hose or any other long items there in the bumper. We have an outside shower, gives us access to hot and cold water there on the valve. The sprayer is going to have an on-off switch, allow us to conserve our water consumption there. This all does kind of wrap up and store in that single, into that compartment. We have, of course, our spare tire back here. So one other thing worth noting here at the rear is going to be the Furon backup camera mount. What that means for you is it is pre-wired to easily add a backup camera at any point in time. Something you may want to take advantage of. It's going to make things a lot easier. It's going to give you that full rear view going down the road. Makes it easy to do so. If you do have any questions on what you would need or availability of such, go ahead and talk to our parts department. They'd be happy to go ahead and get that ordered for you. So making our way here around to the passenger side of the unit, of course, you notice the awning, the speakers, things like that. We're going to get to the operation of those on the inside. They are, again, obviously controlled on the inside of the unit. Other than that, we have a all-weather 15 amp outlet here, allows you to take advantage of powering any other equipment that you may be utilizing when enjoying this space. We have a standard kind of RV style assist rail. We'll start out, or its travel position is against the body. Some people like it against the door, others like it against the body like so. Either way, you need to lift that up, move that into that outward position. It's gonna lock into that position there. We also, of course, have your Lippert solid step here. Now, you can adjust these legs for ground clearance. We're pretty good here, but if you were inclined to do so, what you would do is, of course, you need to open the door first. You can then go ahead and lift this up. Maybe a little hard to see on camera, but you have some pins here. You can go ahead and remove that pin. And then, of course, you have different settings here. If you're on uneven ground or whatever, you can make up for that with that adjustment. Now, the door does need to be fully open. So once that is open, you just go ahead and grab that step. We're going to go ahead and put it in. It will click into that kind of stowed position. And then, of course, the big yellow handle here is how you unlatch it. So you just rotate that. That will allow you to come down. And of course, you're ready to go. When we take a look here at the door, it's worth noting the kind of the way you're going to lock things up or secure the unit on the entry door. This bottom cylinder is going to control the deadbolt. So when it comes to locking it, we, of course, insert our key. We're going to turn to the left. and then we need to return back to center to go ahead and remove our key. Here on the latch portion of the lock, it's going to lock with the same key, but in a slightly different way. So it's going to, when we lock that, we're going to move that into the secondary position, and there's no need to come back to center. So we can just go ahead and remove the key from that locked position. A couple things worth noting with that. Moving on here, just going to take a look down low, make sure we're not missing anything, and it looks like we're good to go. We have our front storage compartment here. Now this is going to utilize a little tap lens, so you have a light in there to light the compartment, and it is just a push button on the center of the lens. And then we have an on-off toggle switch here, and that's going to turn those blue lights there that we see on the front, so it's going to make for a really cool effect, and that's going to be where that switch is located. Just about covers it here on the exterior of the EV1. We're going to hop on the inside and take a look at those operations and features on the inside. So here on the interior of the EV1, we're going to come right down here because we got a lot going on right here inside the door. First things first, we have a very important piece of safety equipment. That's going to be your fire extinguisher, obviously. It does have a test tab here on the top, so push that green button down. If it springs back, that means we still have pressure within the unit. If it stays depressed, you're just going to go ahead and dispose of that and get a new one. We have your GFI protected outlet here. Now, all of the receptacles here in this unit are on the same circuit. What that means, if one of them were to get overloaded, that they are all going to fall in suit and be in op. We would need to go ahead and reset that to restore functionality. Now also, our fireplace and our microwave are on the same circuit as well. Those are both semi-hydraul appliances, so it was not recommended or not possible to run them both at the same time. So what we're going to do is have to choose what we want to run. So as you can see, you have a standard light switch style there. That's going to let you pick and choose whether you want to run the microwave or the fireplace. Coming up top here, we have a very kind of a standard panel that you're going to find in really any camper. It's going to be your convenience center. We have your tank monitors here and battery levels. So here on the scale, the more light you see, the fuller that is. Our battery is full. Battery is going to read full anytime we are plugged into shore power running that inverter, because it's recharging those batteries. Fresh water is full, black water is empty, gray water 1 is empty, and gray water 2, as you can see, so when I go to push that, it's not even lighting up because there is no secondary gray water holding tank. This is kind of a generic panel that Forest River Palomino uses throughout multiple coaches, so you may find one that has a second gray water holding tank, and that's when that would come into play. We have our slide in and out switch here. I'm not going to spend too much time on that, but we discussed the importance of running that slide fully in and fully out in operation, no short bursts or partial openings. When we say we're going to go ahead and run it in, we're going to hold that switch until the motor stops. So they have an electric brake. There should be no confusion as to when it's fully in or fully out. We have our awning switch here, extend and retract. You can choose how far in and out you want to run that awning. You can follow the sun in the sky if you choose to do so. Keep in mind that awning, you should never leave your space, your camping spot, with that awning in the extended position. They're very expensive to replace. Lightweight by design, they do not take heavy winds well. Awning light here on either side of those awning arms, you're going to have LED lights. Of course, that's just an on-off toggle switch to turn those on and off. Up here, we have our water pump switch, 12-volt water pump switch that's referenced throughout the presentation. This is the location to turn that on and off. Of course, you know it's on because of the lighted switch. And lastly, our living room lights here. Most of the overhead lights are on that common switch. Of course, you can choose which ones come on and off with that switch because they are independently controlled on the fixture as well. Right next to that convenience center, we have your Intellitronics energy management system. Now, this is a really cool system. What this is going to do is manage your load of appliances. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 there. And then we have 6 electric circuits there in the breaker. So we can choose priority of these circuits with what appliances we find most important our expertise, what we find we use the most. We can set priority, like in here in Texas, we're not gonna want our air conditioner to be number 6. We would probably want that to be number 1 because we want that air conditioner to be running all the time. This is also gonna give you a real-time readout of how much of your load or capacity you're using. It says right now, like we're at 12% load because we don't have a lot running right now. Now, if we had the air conditioner on, the microwave, things like that, that may go way up. It's also going to tell you how many amps you're using, things like that. And then again, allow you to set priority on those circuits as to what you find most important or find that you're using most often. Hopping up here, we have our Furon stereo units, CD, DVD, AM, FM radio, Bluetooth. All of those features are going to be utilized through this. Of course, it is remote controlled. Also does have an app. I find most people are generally somewhat familiar with these. One thing worth noting is going to be our zones 1 and 2, marked here on the digital display as well as the push buttons here. We have 2 separate zones. We have a zone here for the inside, that's going to be zone 1, and we have a zone for the outside, which is going to be those outside speakers. Of course, you're going to control the volume separate for each zone, and you're going to do that by selecting it or deselecting it like so. You have a couple presets here as well for radios, and then down here is going to be our mode buttons. Of course, we have a play, pause, stop, left and right seek, Bluetooth button, and then again, here's going to be our mode button that's going to take us through the modes that this offers. Other than that, you have an auxiliary input, 3.5 millimeter jack, a headphone jack, and a USB import as well. Also, here in the kitchen area, we have our television. Now, this is a friction fit. What that means is that it has friction on these, this accordion arm that's going to keep that stowed when going down the road. It will allow you to go ahead and pull that out and kind of position that throughout the camper. Right now, we're just going to go ahead and move that out of the way so we can talk about some other features that we have behind there. Of course, we have our HDMI cord here. What that's doing is that's essentially connecting the Furon unit here to the television. That's going to allow that DVD to play through to the TV. Below that, we have our cable satellite inlets. We've seen the inlet of those services there on the exterior of the unit. This would be the inlet, or this would be the final termination of that plug there on the outside. And then the secondary ones for the rooftop digital over-the-air antenna. What that's going to allow you to do is bring in over-the-air programming in the event that you don't have either a park cable service or an aftermarket satellite package. Now, this red light needs to be on for us to go ahead and take advantage of that digital over-the-air antenna. So we're going to turn that red light on, push button right next to the light. We're then going to do a channel search on the television. It's going to go ahead and search out your best possible signal and bring in programming dependent on that signal. If we go ahead and move this towards the other way, we're going to see a couple USB chargers there, allow you to run any devices, charging any devices from this location. So right up top here, of the side of the bed, we have your Renogy battery monitor charge controller here. This essentially corresponds with the solar. This is going to give you a real-time readout of where your battery sits in terms of voltage, amp hours, 100% charge, things like that. You can circle through. You have some more information you can get from that. It does have a light if you want to go ahead and keep that on. To dim it out, you'll just hold that top button until it goes ahead and turns off. So basically just an information panel to where you're what you're taking in solar, what you're using, where your battery sits, and your percentage of charge. Other than, of course, the cabinetry, which we don't need to spend too terribly much time on. You got USB here on this side of the bed as well. Nice shelf up there, maybe for your phones, things like that. 2 110 volt, 15 amp outlets on either side of the bed as well. These lights here are going to be independently controlled. These do not turn on and off with that main light switch. Above the bed, we have a fan. These little porthole fans are pretty cool. you would go ahead and push this black button. You're going to push that up, and you know, I was trying to do it without crawling on the bed, but looks like I'm gonna have to do so. So you just go ahead and push that in the up position, and then we have that fan. What that's going to do is that's an exhaust fan. So what the idea being is we would open up both of these windows or all of the windows within the unit. We have another fan there towards the rear. We're going to turn both of those fans on. What that's going to do is create a cross breeze, draw that window in through the, or that air in through the windows and then out through the porthole. When not in use, we're just gonna go ahead and make sure we turn that off and hit that black switch and pull down for us. Behind me, an important thing worth noting, we have your emergency exit window. So in the event that your entry door were to be blocked, it's very important to have a secondary exit strategy. What that would entail is going to be removing this screen. So go ahead and yank that out of the way. We are going to remove this from its keeper, and we could then swing this window full open like a doggy door. Now, if we want to just operate it like a standard window, we have a catch there that will allow us to feed air from the window. This window is going to differ in operation from the rest of the windows. We're going to show you how those operate here in just a few minutes. But once we return this to service, we can go ahead and take a look here at the shades. You have these kind of pull down projector style shades, which are really cool. Coming on here to the dinette, other than the, of course, storage that you have on the underside, which is very indicative of what you generally see, we have a secondary sleeping space here. So when making out that bed, it's gonna be easiest if you go ahead and remove the cushions first. So we're gonna go ahead and get those out of the way. So with those out of the way, we are going to remove the tabletop from the poles and the four pedestals. So what you have is you have a flange on both the tabletop and the floor, and then you have the bar here that connects the two. So if you're lucky, you can go ahead and remove the tabletop from the floor flanges, and you're gonna set that aside momentarily. Now these are generally a friction fit here on the top, but they actually screw into the floor. So this can get, we find people have some trouble with these. So once you've removed it, which you're just gonna turn it counterclockwise to do so, when it does come to replacing it, I always just kind of back this out with my hand first. It's gonna give me a far more likelihood of catching that flange. So what I would do then is line that up. And then as I turn this, that's gonna tighten down that little screw, and we're just gonna make sure that's tight. So we're gonna then remove, so we're making out the bed, we're gonna remove both of these poles. We're then gonna come back to our tabletop, and we're going to set that here on these black bumpers. They do have Velcro in place to help keep that stable if you're moving around in your sleep or getting on and off the bed. So with that in place there, we're going to then take our cushions. We're going to take the seat cushions and place those back in their original positions. And then we're going to take our back cushions and place them over the table. And sometimes these cushions can, these setups can fit pretty tightly. So you just kind of tuck it in there, and then the tension is going to keep that in place. And then just because it's slightly more complicated than a standard pedestal style table, we'll go ahead and we will put it back up for you. Put those in place. Remove our top. Set that to the side. Start by backing our screws out here. We're going to put those into the flange. Line up everything nice and true. And then with those nice and tight, we take our tabletop. Line everything up and kind of snap it into place. Super easy, super quick, shouldn't give you any problems. If we take a look here at these windows, this is going to be what you're going to find with the remainder of the windows throughout the unit, except for the emergency. So what you have here is a little turn button there. That's going to open up those windows. You can see you get about 6 inches worth of opening there. Really, the best selling point to this style of window is that you can still have them open if it's raining. You're not going to have any of that rain come in. To close them, just the opposite, counterclockwise. You don't have to bear down on those. Just snug is fine. So just turn them until they stop. And then again, you have that projector style pull down shade here for this window as well. Up top here of the dinette, another important piece of safety equipment is going to be your smoke alarm. Now this is a pretty standard smoke alarm, runs on a 9-volt battery, same variant you may have inside your house. My recommendation is keep a spare 9-volt battery with you. That will, in the event that that were to start indicating to you that it's getting low, you can go ahead and replace it on the road. Again, we're going to go ahead and test this every single time we take the unit out. Another similar max fan here, going to operate the very same way as the one above the bed does. We have our air conditioner unit here. Now we have a couple options here. We have this low heat option. So keep in mind that this does not have a standard furnace here. So all of our heat is going to come from the electric heating element within the air conditioner here. So we turn this to low heat, and we need to go ahead and turn this dial there onto the hot side. Once we've done so, this is going to start producing electric heat. It will work great for a unit of this size in most temperatures. So if we're back to operating the air conditioner, we're going to turn past that. We have low fan, we have high fan, we have low cool, high cool, and that's it. So then we turn all the way back around to the off position. So also an important feature to mention about the air conditioner is going to be removing the filters for maintenance. Of course, you're going to go ahead and peel this out of the way, and then you are going to remove the filter. Now these are washable, reusable filters. Just go ahead and rinse them off in the sink, give them time to dry, and you should get many years of use out of those. When replacing them, we just line everything up properly. Slide that in there. We're gonna take our cover, again, line up everything correctly. And then you have some tabs here, and you just gotta work those in the best you can. Here into the kitchen, of course, we have this roll-out sink cover, which is nice. It's going to show us a nice, large, single bay stainless steel sink. We have our induction cooktop. Works very well. Of course, you have your controls here. Power, temperature, increase, decrease for each burner, things like that. So, works very well. Dropping down here, we have our convection grill and microwave. So definitely a ton of options with how you prep your food here in this unit. Far more inclusive than what you're going to normally find with a propane driven cooktop and oven. So again, microwave, convection, as well as a grill option here with this appliance. Down below here, another very important piece of safety equipment. This is your carbon monoxide LP leak detector. This particular appliance is wired into the 12-volt section of the camper. It's number one, it's very important that we do test it every single time we take the unit out along with the rest of the safety equipment. This will indicate to you on which one of those gases it is sensing. It will also indicate to you if your batteries are getting to be too low. So a couple different indicators here or scales right there on the front. It's going to alert you with an audible tone as well as flashing lights. So you'll have to look here to see what those flashing lights mean for you. Moving around here, we have our fuse panel, our breaker box here. This is going to be our 1 through 6 breakers that I outlined there on the panel. You can see in terms of what they correspond with here on the door. And then again, they're standard light switch resettable breaker, as much as to what you're going to be used to in the residential sector. And then beside that, we have our automotive blade style 12 volt side of that. Again, you're going to see here what those fuses correspond with. Not a bad idea to pick up a variety pack of fuses, keep them with the unit in the event that either one of these 50s, and I believe those are 20s as well. So 15s and 20s are all you'll need. In the event that they burn out, it's nice to have a spare so you can go ahead and replace them. Up here to the refrigerator. Now this is a 12 volt compressor style refrigerator. These are very quiet. They work very well. For this particular model, our temperature control is going to be here right inside the door. So you have colder, cold and coldest. So you have that full scale there to turn it off. If, of course, you're just going to put that to the indicator. So these work exceptionally well. They don't consume a terrible amount of energy. And they work well. You don't have to go through that kind of headache of making sure the camper is 100% level like you would with an ammonia absorption system. I think that we're going to see the industry kind of move more towards this as time goes on. So to my left here, we have your electric fireplace. If I go ahead and turn that on, we can go ahead and see the flames. They are adjustable in terms of the brightness. And I think this one may have different colored lights. Yeah, so you can have like blues, oranges, or whatever. Also has a electric heater in there as well, so you can actually have this produce heat along with the air conditioner electric heating element within that. You'll find all of your controls here along the top side, and then it you know shows you the displayed options there on the actual screen. So really cool. I believe this also does have a remote control as well, so you can, if you're sitting in bed, you can kind of turn the intensity up or down either way. Of course, some storage here on the either side. So here into the restroom, first thing worth talking about is going to be the corner shower. For a smaller kind of bathroom that you're going to find generally in these units, they've made a very efficient choice by using this corner shower. With these big, large domed doors, it gives you kind of the illusion of a much bigger space. Functionality is going to be very straightforward as to what you generally see. You're going to have a hot and cold mixing valve on-off switch there on the fixture. That's all generally what you're going to find in these. When going down the road, it's important that you close these doors and use this little rubber bungee to go ahead and slip over that knob to go ahead and keep those from moving too terribly much going down the road. Turning around here, we have your toilet. This is a pedal style toilet, has a porcelain bowl. It's going to be a light press here on the pedal to actually feed water to the bowl, a full press to flush. Now, it's recommended that you do keep some water there in the bowl. What that's going to do is that's going to help keep those bad smells down when you flush, as well as keep that blade seal nice and wet and lubricated. So products that you're going to be using here is, number one is going to be a single ply RV grade toilet paper. We want that to dissolve easily in that black water holding tank. We're also going to use a deodorizing product. You may decide to use a tissue dissolver. Whether those products are like the toss-in pods or the liquid form, they're all going to be introduced right here directly at the toilet. So just follow the instructions on the bottle and you'll be in good shape there. Other than that here, you're going to find that your toilet paper holder and your towel rack have not been mounted by either me or the manufacturer. I think both of us are in the mindset that you would probably like to choose where those items are located so you can go ahead and mount them yourself. Other than the cabinetry that we see here, we also have the medicine cabinet. And then right here inside the door, you're going to find the main light switch here, but we also do have a cool secondary light here on the actual exhaust fan, so that nice halo light. And then again, we've seen the operation of this fan, but those are on two separate switches. So one for the fan, one for the light. So that just about concludes the system operations here with the Revolve EV1 by Palomino. We hope you learned something. We hope you enjoyed the walkthrough. If you do have any further questions or concerns, please don't hesitate to give us a call or comment on the video. We do hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much.